lots of viruses. So Bernd will talk about Net2O in the times of the new coronavirus, which is not so new anymore.
Yeah, it's not so new anymore, and I'm still not finished with what I wanted. The internet is still a bad gateway. We have figured out a number of ways to communicate, but are not fully happy. So first, the thing about surveillance, what people have come up is with surveillance to use for epidemics control.
Sorry, Bernd, you are covering your slides at the moment. Please move your face to the other side. Thank you.
Is it on the right side now? Okay. So we have smartphone location tracking for contract tracing that was started somehow in China with a contact state and a QR code for entrance. And as far as I have heard, the QR code for the entrance in China is almost nowhere used anymore because there is no virus in China. But so they have rolled that back after they conquered the virus. And here we have an RKI, the Robert Koch Institute app, which does some contract tracing in a data protected way. And not many people are using it. In Singapore, they started with this project. And Google and Apple built that framework into the operating system. And unfortunately, it's depends on many people using it, and it's not effective if just 20% of the population use it or so. What also happened is that in China, they detected early on that the virus can stay alive on cash for up to 2 weeks, they said. So everybody pays there without cash, and that is also in other countries. You are recommended not to pay with cash because in the laboratory you can extract the virus from the cash, and you don't know if that happens in real world as well, but it's just sticky on this kind of material. And of course, if you pay with WeChat or Alipay with a credit card, every payment is monitored. So what's more important is that everybody went into home office and video conferences are everywhere, like this video conference. And the video conference software status about privacy is poor, mostly because the software is either very old or it is operated by these surveillance capitalists like Zoom, where your data goes, where it makes money. And the progress on Net2O was that nothing for this kind of stuff, doing data, doing video conferences, or having a way to do contract tracing without data revealing is ready or useful. And Snowden wrote a book. So I wave Snowden's book in front of you. Permanent Record, where he says a number of things, and also about the social networks and the companies who operate this kind of business. Is not just social networks. And few of us understood it at that time, but none of the things that we go on to share would belong to us anymore. The successor of the e-commerce companies that failed had failed because they couldn't find anything we were interested in buying, now had a new product to sell. That new product was us. So mainly it's not just us, it is what they want to sell as ads to companies that things, they still have something to sell to us, and they want to, these companies want to manipulate our mind. And so what they do is to take our attention, our activities, our locations, our desire, everything about us that we revealed, knowingly or not, was being surveyed and sold in secret or in open even, so as to delay the inevitable failing of violations that is for most of us coming only now. And this surveillance would go on to be actively encouraged and even funded by an army of governments greedy for the vast volume of intelligence that they would gain. Now that is, in the book, is somewhat libertarian framing this last sentence, because it looks like the government is the evil part. The companies just get funded and do what they can sell, and the government grabs all that. But Snowden corrected this, and Cory Doctorow wrote a long article on 1.0, that is the Medium blog. And it's not really an article, it's really a book, where he describes in great detail how the surveillance capitalism, as he calls it, creates all of this, or many of these adverse effects of the current internet, because they want to sell ads to people as products, not the people themselves, ads to people. So they want to sell mind control. If you are in this 5G enables the mind control race, thinking, no, it's not 5G. It's already working with 3G. If you just log into Facebook, you get those mind control rays as they are sold to the advertisers on Facebook. They're not quite working, but they are sold. And Snowden also made clear that this libertarian framing is not his thing. So he actually said in an interview a few months ago, we have legalized abuse of the person and entrenched a system that makes populations vulnerable for the benefit of private companies. So it's actually already the private companies which benefit. The problem is not data protection, because in the EU we have this GDPR. It's data collection. GDPR assumes that data was all collected properly in the first place. That's not the case. It is as if it's okay to spy on everyone as long as the data never leaks. When it does, it is not data being exploited, it's people. So actually, if a company collects data, he says about leaks, it's not just leaks, they sell it to ad sellers. So leak is built into the system. It's not unintentional. The unintentional leak is part of the problem. If, I had a few years ago, I had these bubbles of growing leaks. That is one part of the problem. But these companies buy the data to sell it, or collect the data to sell it. And so it doesn't leak. It just is intentional. The doors, the flood doors are open for these data. A leak is something where your flood door is closed. It's open. So even here, he says it's the leak is the problem. That's not quite the case. Yes, if they leak, it's more of a problem because they don't even get the money they wanted, but they want to sell this data. And at least the effect of this data. So there's another thing I learned during this pandemic that is about disinformation and how it spreads. And because the WHO first said there is an information pandemic, but actually that was at the point of time where they were disinforming it as well. They had a number of statements in the early days, like masks are useless and it does not spread by aerosols. And that caused many people to stick to this. So the effect here is the first impression effect, and that means facts later don't change our minds. If you hear something early on, it sticks, and that is very essential to how these biological systems are trained to learn something. It's not just our brain has facts sticking to it. Our immune system learns when it discovers a new kind of virus. It learns the first kind of this virus very thoroughly. And if later a variation comes, it will use the old tools to attack the new variation. And that's why flu is so difficult to attack, because flu is known to us all from childhood, and then it mutates, and the new flu is attacked by the old tools. And that is causing problems. And for flu, it's great because the small mutations, the small change of a protein allows it to escape our immune system. But this also works on our brains. Our brains are wired essentially by the same way of growing connections as our immune system grows antibodies. So when you are told something which is new to you, your brain is empty. It creates traces in your neural network. And these traces, when you see something that is similar, will fire again. That means when you get told masks are useless in March, and in May you are told you have to wear a mask, the people start to object. I have been told wear masks in January because I'm watching CCTV, the Chinese news, and I was very confused when they told me masks are useless. I started to look up in the Lancet of studies, and there are studies back about 100 years ago to today, and they all found masks are useful for respiratory diseases. I have no idea why anybody with a health degree would say otherwise. The next thing is the IKEA effect. So when you buy the furniture, this low quality furniture from the Swedish manufacturer that looks ugly, you have to assemble it on your own. And by doing so, you add value to it, at least in your mind, because it's not easy to obtain now, it's difficult. And that effect means, so if you have to invest work in something, the thing you produce has more value to you for something that you don't invest work. And that's, for example, used by the QAnon theorists. They don't tell you what their conspiracy theory is. They say, Google it up, watch this hour-long things on YouTube, and you will be informed. And then you do it, and then you invested hours of your time for this bullshit, and because you invested something, it now has a value, just because you invested something. This kind of things manipulate our mind in a very scary way. There's other human traits, that is, you have a worldview, you think you understand the world, and you dismiss facts that don't fit into this worldview. The result is that science needs to be prudent. It's not just you push out your discussion at the general public before you know anything, because then you get the first impression. It's also not so that you hide everything, because then you can call this IKEA effect. That the thing, people who find something of the hidden things or something difficult will stick to it. Science puts a lot of effort into this IKEA effect by creating vocabularies that is difficult to learn. And science has a lot of problems due to this effect, because scientists also stick to the things they had first impressed and said they had a hard time to learn. So science needs to be prudent and needs to be careful about what it says. It needs to be careful to figure out the truth before it tells the people. The Chinese were criticized a lot because they went to the WHO end of December, and then they shut up for 3 weeks, mostly, not completely, but they shut up. And then they released, we have done a lot of work in these 3 weeks. We have found the genetic sequence. We have found how it transmits. We have found a lot of scary things, like it enters your eyes and then gets replicated there and then enters your nose and you get infected through your eyes. So you have to wear glasses and a mask. And the people here said, you have to wash your hands. That was not what the Chinese found out. Yeah, maybe you have to wash your hands. That is good for hygienic in general, but that's not the main transmission. We were told wash hands, and that got stuck on the people. And then there's this thing, the plausibility. Like when you have Bill Gates in this series, here's Bill Gates in a mugshot. He's beaded with his father's 9/11 in Albuquerque. Now this man does evil things even when he just drives his father's 9/11.
Your face is covering Bill Gates at the moment.
Okay, so you can see Bill Gates now.
Yes, confirmed.
Yeah, so he speeded with his father's 9/11. This is in December 77. It's a long time ago. You just give this man a tool and he will abuse it, and he did that many times. So he doesn't need to chip you. He already has everything evil he wanted from you, except if his business approach has failed. There's funny things about the QAnon. Some people suspect that it's from an Italian group calling themselves Wu Ming, which means five names. Some say it means Wu Ming, no names, this Wu. But when you pronounce it the same way as no names, it also means ignorance. And that is the real cause for QAnon, not Wu Ming. It's just ignorance that makes people fall on these theories because they have empty minds. And then the first impression can paint whatever you want to paint there. And the IKEA effect makes sure it sticks. So this kind of disinformation flow that is working on the internet is not new. It did work before there was an internet. It did work when preachers went from village to village and told people about religions. That is exactly the same effect. And they all take all these tools. So about this antisocial hate works, I already told last time. And what I'm more and more convinced is that the free speech, the problem is the speech that is too generic, because speech is really everything. If you lie and do deception, that is speech, but that deserves no protection. And then you do claims, scientific claims, or claims that appear to be scientific, you need proof and evidence. It's not just you can be protected for everything. The truth needs protection because the truth is the weakest thing here. If you want to tell the truth, you need a fast horse. It looks like because the lies are traveling faster. It's not because you have to run away from somebody. The lies is the way this antisocial hate works, the networks today work, allow lies to speed fast through the networks. And disinformation and strange theories speed faster. Even if the Postillon tried, our satirical magazine tried to spread fake news about one of these corona deniers, and it actually worked. Hundreds of people believed that story he posted yesterday and are now very angry with Attila Hildmann, our main proponent of this corona denial. So yeah, you can use that for all kind of lies and deception. It works. So get to the main topic, the video streaming conferences. How do we do that on a peer-to-peer system? Because it's not easy on peer-to-peer. People have been trying peer-to-peer video streaming and conferences like Jitsi, and it doesn't work quite well. The first thing is live stream, meaning sending unfinished files. So the usual way of peer-to-peer sharing the workload by sending out the hashes and everybody gets these files piece by piece does not work because you don't have the hashes. It's not finished. It's work in progress. I need a different approach for multiplexing because so far for the finished files, I know the file size in before and I can calculate the chunk size. If the file is exceeded, if I reach the end of the file, it's not contributing anymore. But with live streaming, every file can contribute some bytes at any moment. So I need metadata for the chunk size of the next chunk. That was relatively easy and straightforward to fix that. What I also figured out is that using a single file for video streaming is not a good idea. You want to have an index file, you want to have a data file for audio, data file for video, and the index file is also separated for audio and video. And you have maybe some metadata like subtitles and things. You want to have them also as separate files because having things as files makes it easier to think about this. And the multiplexing is doing it in the transmission, is doing the job to get them all over the wire, not use a prepared streaming format where you have one file and you still have this problem of the chunk size, so you don't gain anything. As the quality of what you want to send depends on the bandwidth, both of you and of your receiver. So you need to measure bandwidth. And when you distribute something in the tree, it's somebody in between has to scale down. One solution would be scalable codecs. H.265 has that option, but it's not the standard option. So you cannot use the available hardware encoders to do that. And you want the available hardware encoders. Otherwise, it's consuming too much CPU time or too slow. The way you stream is for conferences, you have a thumbnail stream and a full screen stream, and normally the people subscribe to the thumbnail stream and the full screen stream only when you need. You have to synchronize audio for movies because otherwise it's not lip sync. But for conferences where people talk with each other, asynchronous is a better way, except when you have a presentation, because then you read the lips of the presenter and you watch his slides and then you can go synchronous. So that is the distribution scheme I have in mind. So you have colored nodes. The root is hosting a stream and sends out parts different colored parts to different parties, and they all send it over to each other. So in the end, they can all reassemble the full data. And maybe one of these colors is XOR of the other blocks. So if one packet drops, you still have all the data. And that's the tree can be extended because really there's always one node which has not full coverage, and you can stick on that node. For example, this node here is sending only three green arrows back, so it has still a spare arrow where you can connect to. So you can extend this kind of tree in every state by attaching to a particular node which still has three arrows, one free slot for distributing. And in this case, when you have two layers full, you would start the next layer. But if not all of these layers are full, you can stick in between. So that kind of tree can grow and grow and grow and distribute very well. The problem now for a video conference is that you don't have this root, or you think you don't have this root, because every participant has something to send up. But you can let the leaf nodes send their streams uplink. And so when a participant wants to have a full screen of the leaf, he can join the leaf stream itself, then that becomes the root. Or when he wants to have an overview, then he uses the root stream. So the branch nodes can mix the leaf node streams and their own stream and downscale it and re-encode it and send it upwards. And the root node combines the final downmix and distributes that. So this turns n to n into an n to one and a one to n distribution. So, and we have the tools for that can be handled. So every participant upstreams one stream, and yeah, downstream maybe more, because you have incoming streams from several leaves. But that works quite well with DSL, with asymmetry. You have more downstream bandwidth. The upstream bandwidth is limiting you. And the moderator, the root, provides instruction for mixing and downscaling for the branch and leaves, and also can kick out nodes that they don't like, or mute them. Now that architecture is doable, but not yet done. And we have a lot of wish list items collected. So you want the stream from the camera and have crop features. You want a stream from the desktop or window. You want to have scaled down streams, scaled up stream for talking participants. You want to have two talking participants side by side with upscale streams. Should be possible when people talk to each other. Zoom does it quite well. And you want to have audio mixer and auto level, but you don't want to have the auto level be so strong that it increases whatever background noises there is to full volume. You want to have this, you are muted if you talk while being muted or disconnected. That is also, people got disconnected. I at the moment can't see if I'm connected. If I'm disconnected, I talk and talk and talk and you don't hear me. You want to have hotkeys. That is pretty standard. You want to have cute visualization for the audio like FFT, because some microphones have noise bands, and then you can apply a filter like a notch and kill this noise band. You want to have push to talk if you have a bad microphone and echo. We want to have hotkeys for cut marks and keyframes, because often you want to cut afterwards. That is things that OBS can also do. At some point of the feature list, I would say let OBS do this, but for the basic things, there should be integrated, like templates for nice presentations, like what I've done with OBS, have my picture left, have my picture right, have me full screen, have nothing of me, and that kind of thing that can be done with OBS. These simple things is should be in templates, so you can have nice presentations. You should allow multiple devices, because Net2O is a multi-device protocol. So if I don't like my laptop's webcam, I should be able to use my mobile's webcam, which is much, much better. And yeah, logos for talks, countdown clocks for talk slots. I don't know if I'm over time. Share slides directly. We have seen that with BBB, it does it quite well. Subtitles as options, because sometimes you have a larger audience with multiple languages and you want subtitles. Translated audio tracks for bigger conferences like the CCC, when you have people doing online real-time translation. Rooms for small groups, site conversions, of course. That is just a room, it's just a chat room that is just joining different chat rooms. That is not difficult to implement. Moderator side channel for the presenter, which we don't have here. For example, if the moderator wants to tell me, hurry up, you don't have time, I have no side channel for this in BBB. You might need to try connections to different participants in this tree distribution and take the best one, because they are not all connected equal. And you might want to mix additional audio sources like background music, desktop sounds, laughers, claps. And what's also nice for discussions is spatial audio. So the different participants appear to speak from different directions. That is a nice feature to have, because normally what we talk is mono and it's mapped into the middle of the screen and everybody's speaking from the middle of the screen, and our brain does not like that when you see the pictures side by side. So what I also figured out, what I need to work on, and I'm still doing that and still changing that, is the who as what. That is a very important property in sharing things in a peer-to-peer system. The normal way is you have some tracker, like a DHT. Your query reveals who wants what. You can encrypt the tracks, so the query reveals who wants has the same thing. You might do onion routing, and that is too complex and slow. So I decided to put the who has what within the chat log structure, and that is changing at the moment, because I figured out this has to be treated exactly like a normal chat message, but it must be invisible. So I now add invisible chat log messages. It must be signed, so you know this is actually the person who is really this person. It's not faked, and it might have an expiration time because people might keep the things only for a short period of time. So, and the chat message also already do all this kind of things. Who is a device and a pub key? Because it's not a person, it's a device which has the thing. If you have multiple devices, one might have this thing and another doesn't have it. So as last year already stated, the non-technical problem is how do you get your contacts over to Net2O? What I want to avoid is that the people who use Net2O first are just people who've left from the censorship of some other network because they are the least people to build up a community. It's like when we leave Usenet and only you, Ecola, is left there, then he's a refugee of censorship because otherwise he would be shut down. So that makes social networks an awful place when you have no way to shut down people. That is why Usenet is broken. And that is also, if you create a censorship resilient network and first only the refugees come to your networks, then it will start as ugly place right from the start. Funding, I still have money left, but I tried to do the NLNet fund for European secure internet, but it looks like they have the typical academic approach. So what they really want back is OSI, ISO layers or something like that. They want to build on the existing things that have been there for 30 years and change as little as possible, and that's not possible. So here I have a few links. Not all of the things I've said here are linked here. For example, I did not link the big book from Cory Doctorow, but there are some interesting reads here. Sascha Lobo's read is in German. He explains the IKEA effect, and this New Yorker explains why we stick to things. It's all quite interesting information about how people deal with information, and it's not sane. And really, Scotty, beam me up. There's no intelligent life on this planet, and the whole mechanism how life processes information has these flaws, and inevitably has these flaws. So if we build KIs which work the same way, they fail the same way. So that's my talk. That is still work in progress, and I need to get to implement all these things.
Bernd, thank you very much for this very interesting talk, and I'm sure there are questions. Any questions? Gerhard?
I would like to know.
Yeah.
Yes, I would like to know more about the avalanche tree. Has this been your idea? Has this been researched? How is the would the avalanches continue, or is it just two layers of this and then there's a normal piece?
Yes, this is not researched. This is my idea, and this has to scale. So you decide how many nodes you have in each layer. That is a design decision depending on what you want to do. For example, in real-time streaming, you want low latency, so you want to have more layers, more nodes in one layer and not scale it up. In other settings, the latency is not important, so you can go upwards with the tree. You can always add to this tree. Here you can add people to this node. This has a spare one. This node has a spare one. This node has a spare one. And this node has a spare one.
Oh, so you share your screen.
Yeah, I need to share my screen. Okay. Here's the avalanche tree. So this node, and this node have a spare bandwidth.
We cannot see it.
No. Still just have your camera view.
Thank you. Here we go. Works. Thank you.
Okay. It's the right key, the right hotkey. Yeah. So this node, and this node have only three uplinks, so they're still one short of this. The others all have four uplinks. You can attach to them, but then you are next layer. When you are the next layer, you are the free one. You can share your bandwidth. So people can attach on the side of you. So you can grow this tree until every node is until one level is full, and then you end up in the next level and you can grow there. So this tree grows organically. You just need to know which node in the tree has the free bandwidth and assign the people who want to join to this particular node. And it makes sure that everybody, when they transmit the same thing, has the same upstream and downstream bandwidth requirements. What is not solved in this tree is if you have poor bandwidth, and particularly if you have poor upload bandwidth, but download is okay, because then you cannot share. So in this case, you need to be a leecher, you need to suck bandwidth from the other participants which have more upstream bandwidth, and you cannot contribute. But as long as the rest has enough total uplink bandwidth, it's okay. This thing also can show the proof that when you share something on a peer-to-peer network, everybody uploads everything only once. Or like the other colors, they don't upload at all, and their own colors, they upload once.
Okay, thank you.
So, next question.
There's a question in Twitch.
Yes, the question is from Porto Sky. Oh, you want to read it already? Sorry, I didn't know.
Yeah, what kind of latencies are you seeing from when a speaker talks to when someone might hear them?
You are seeing latencies in the 100 millisecond range. And that comes from a number of reasons. The first thing is the audio interfaces inside your phone or your computer is not very low. So you're already seeing something like 50 millisecond latency there. And then you encode blocks. You don't encode small blocks. You normally encode 10 to 20 millisecond blocks. And then you send it around on the internet, where you have hop to hop is about 20 milliseconds. So the internet is not the major latency. The major latency is already in your device from through pulse audio or open SLES is in the 100 millisecond range.
Then it's strange, but not really noticed. Yeah.
You will not notice a 100 millisecond range. You have to think about a 30 meter distance in reality. And
So if you're in a lecture hall, then
if you're in a lecture hall, you have longer latencies from the speaker to you.
Okay, right.
That is okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you very much. And a last question from Steven. Unmute your mic. Did you have a question, Steven? I saw you waving your hand.
Yes, yes. Yeah. It's, okay. Sorry. It was just it was just that I had to get the cursor off another monitor.
Right.
Ben, you said you'd actually started looking for funding.
Yes.
What sort of bodies are you applying to?
The body I applied to so far was NLNet. That is a European initiative, which is funding a number of projects like Jitsi, and it looks like what they like to fund is people who have working stuff for ages and just want to add a few feature here or there.
Do they have? I mean, do they have the usual mission statement that tells you which boxes to tick in order to get money? Both Klaus and I have some experience in getting money out of the EU.
I can't read their mission statements. It looks to me like marketing bullshit.
Ah. Okay, that's the problem. You have to learn to read those documents, and once you've read the documents and understand them, then it's actually you're into the better than a 30% chance of getting the money. In the times when we did it, 30% of the people failed because they couldn't get into they couldn't read the forms, they couldn't fill in the forms. And 30% were dreadful projects. So getting into the upper 30% was extremely tedious and it took a very long time, but the money was worth having.
Yeah, I think I can read the forms, but what I think is that I need to speak the marketing bullshit to convince them that my project is worth funding.
Only you can answer that question as to whether it's worth learning how to bullshit. I suspect that anybody who's run a business for more than a few years has a bullshit factor that they can apply as required.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, maybe you can take this offline and talk about
funding. I think that may well be. I wish this was face to face because it's a perfect face to face discussion.
Yeah, and we're even streaming. So, there's the last question from Dirk in the chat, and he asked which Cory Doctorow book did you reference? And Carsten is.
It's an article on Medium. It's just the size of a book. I can post the link.
That would be great. Okay. Thank you very much. It was a very nice talk. I enjoyed it very much.